It's so nice to be here with you today. So nice to be here with you to pray. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Won't you please, won't you pray for your neighbor? Welcome to this week's episode of Father Ralph's Neighborhood. I'm Father Ralph. This is my neighborhood. I am still suffering, which is going into my second week now, with a head cold, just right here. And I've had colds like this before, so I'm not worried, but it makes doing even simple things like our neighborhood difficult, because I can hardly talk. I was feeling good, and then began to lose my voice again because of the, I won't go into all the medical stuff, but boy, thank God, I finally felt good enough to do this. The scripture we're working on is from last Sunday, the seventh Sunday in ordinary time. But since we've been delayed by my ongoing battle with my head cold, we've also passed Ash Wednesday, and this is being dropped on the second day of Lent. So Lent is well underway, and I'm really looking forward to being able to spend these days of Lent with all of you. Let's reflect on the scripture from this past Sunday, which actually is a really neat entry into the season of Lent. This is taken from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 5, verses 38 to 48. We're still listening to Jesus give his Sermon on the Mount. Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, offer no resistance to one who is evil. When someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn the other one as well. If anyone wants to go to law with you over your tunic, hand over your cloak as well. Should anyone press you into service for 1 mile, go for 2 miles. Give to the one who asks of you. Do not turn your back on one who wants to borrow. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father. For he makes his sun rise on the bad and the good, and causes rain to fall on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, well, what recompense will you have? Do not the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brothers and sisters only, well, What is unusual about that? Do not the pagans do the same? So be perfect, just as your Heavenly Father is perfect. The Gospel of our Lord. I remember back in my coaching days, this time of year we would be kind of in the big tournament seasons, and I would be losing my voice, kind of like now, but that wasn't from a cold, it was just from yelling and screaming at the side of the mat. But the net benefit was that it shortened my sermon substantially, because I could hardly talk. But the good thing about that was it made my messages really, well, it made them really to the point. So last weekend, this past Sunday, I preached about, well, what are we gonna do for Lent? And there is a point where, you know, we have a real desire, which was kind of ingrained in us, I think, by the nuns, by tradition, our parents. What are you gonna give up for Lent? And so, you know, a lot of times we spend some time thinking, what, this is kind of a two-edged sword, you know. On the one hand, what do I need to give up? What would be good for me to give up? Because Lent is a time for change, right? And on the other hand, what do you think I could do for the 40 days and nights of Lent? What can I faithfully give up? I admired my neighbor across the street, Bob Flynn. And shout out to Bob if he happens to see this. But his thing, he didn't even have to think about it, because he loved making a nice pot of home popped popcorn. And, you know, he would give up popcorn for Lent. And I really admired that. But, you know, when he got home from Mass with his family on Easter Sunday, first thing he did was went right into the kitchen and popped a big pot of popcorn. So when it's one of the, I call them the three pillars of Lent. We're taught that in order to have a good Lent, we need to pray more. We do need to fast or give something up. And we need to give alms. And giving alms, you know, a lot of times we think that means just donating money. But you know what? We could give a lot more than money during Lent. We can give of our time and our talent to make a difference in the lives of our family and friends. So those are the three pillars on which Lent is built. So we reflect and we say, all right, how am I going to live this season of Lent? One of our families at Quigley, the whole family, it was a big family, wonderful Irish Catholic family, the Walsh family, they unplugged every radio. They unplugged the TVs, and for the entire duration of Lent, no television, no radios. And you know, in our current day and age, that'd be a little bit harder to enforce, because now we walk around and do business on, make phone calls on devices that can stream music to us, can stream videos to us. It's hard to unplug your phone. I don't know about all of you, but I actually go through withdrawal, I think, when I try to give up my phone. But what they discovered, and why they actually looked forward to doing this as a family every year during Lent, is when you turn stuff off, you have more time to give to your family, to your friends, to yourself. At Quigley, we used to teach the philosophy of pies, P-I-E-S. And we strive to grow physically, intellectually, emotionally, and spiritually. And everyone, every student that went through Quigley knows about pies. And so when you turn off all the distractions, when you give other things up, then you can look more deeply into yourself. How can I use this season of Lent to grow in these important areas of my life? Physically, intellectually, emotionally, spiritually. And I guess maybe for me, it's not so much an issue of turning off the TV as it is of making sure that I'm watching something that's going to do me some good. And I was, because of my cold and everything else, I was just laying around being miserable. And as you know, just from all of the episodes we have here in Father Ralph's neighborhood, my hero is Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers' neighborhood. So I was daring the television. Go ahead, I dare you. Cheer me up. I dare you. And then there was this wonderful documentary. And for those of you who have Amazon, I believe it's free on Amazon Prime. And the name of the documentary is Mr. Rogers and Me. And it was a heartfelt story. This young man who grew up as literally a neighbor of Fred Rogers. And it's, you know, there's a lot of documentaries out there about Mr. Rogers, but this was particularly beautiful because it showed how he entered into this really very wonderful lifelong relationship with Mr. Rogers. And then he went back and he interviewed for the documentary all kinds of people whose lives were literally changed because they knew Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers really was their neighbor. Mr. Rogers was part of their life. And I have to tell you, I was so glad. I said, thank God I was sick. Thank God I had the TV on. Thank God I found that particular documentary. And it came up in the documentary, and of course, there's over and over again in his work. He very masterfully taught us that we are special, right? And that he said to us, I love you just the way you are. And I thought, what a beautiful reflection. And Mr. Rogers, who was an ordained minister, by the way, in teaching children, was also teaching us, you know, we are lovable just the way we are. And we need to hear that because our culture is constantly telling us we're not. That's how corporations make their money, right? You're not, you need to lose weight. You need to get stronger. You need to wear better makeup. You need to, okay? So there's so many things that are wrong with us. And then we begin to believe that message and we feel very poorly about ourselves. And I stopped to think about that, and after that documentary, I was just like, wow, I love you just the way you are. And, well, being a musician, what happened was that I began to think the right side of my brain took over. And the words, I love you just the way you are, connected me immediately to that beautiful song, right? Billy Joel, I love you just the way you are. And this is nothing new for my spirituality. It's actually something that I've taught myself and others. Music, well, maybe it wasn't written as prayer. Maybe it wasn't written for church. But a good love song, a love song that you would without reservation sing to your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your husband, your wife, your children, your grandchildren, your mother, your father. A real heartfelt love song, right? Imagine that song being sung to you by God. God loves you just the way you are. And because of copyright restrictions, one day I'm going to get into this podcasting work enough to know how to do a better production. As you can see, I'm still working off of my iPad because the new computer is, the new computer setup really still isn't set up to record these podcasts. But long story short, right? I can't play it for you. But you could probably hear it, as you've heard it often enough. My mom's favorite love song, You Light Up My Life. Oh, and so I started thinking, first of her singing that song to me as her son. Then as me singing that song to her as my mother, and then ultimately and finally God singing that song to us. How powerful is that? to hear God's voice singing, "You light up my life." I have to tell you, I only made it to one Mass this past weekend. I couldn't have done it without Deacon Gary Michael's help. He literally got me safely to church and got me safely home again. So I only preached to the one congregation last weekend, the 5:15 Mass group. I have never had so many people come up to me after and say, what a great homily. And I'll tell you, and people start telling me their favorite love songs. And that since the homily and since the Mass, that's all they can hear now is God singing their favorite love song to them. And perhaps even more importantly, they sing that song to our Lord. So I don't know what you're giving up for Lent. I don't know what you're doing. You know, a safe thing to give up for Lent is Brussels sprouts, but we'll get back to that maybe later on. But here, homework. What's your favorite love song? And not just a favorite love song. I love a parade. No. What is your all-time favorite love song that really moves your heart and soul when you hear it and when you sing it? And I want you every day this Lent to sing that song to God in prayer and to hear God and His voice singing that song to you. Because really, that's what Lent should be. A season where we celebrate with tremendous joy the powerful love of our Lord for us. Realizing how precious we are in His sight. Realizing that He loves us just the way we are. Then, come Easter, we will be so much more deeply in love with God, more deeply in love with each other, that when we sing the forbidden word, which I can't sing right now because it's Lent, when we're out at the Easter vigil and we're singing, we are truly a new creation, the Lord blessing us with the powerful gift of His love. And we celebrate with tremendous joy how the Lord's love and His forgiveness and His mercy have saved us and raised us up. We'll see. A few more days of putting my feet up and resting, if I can get rid of this wonderful head cold. But, you know, I think sometimes God does that to me to keep me humble and to say, you need to spend a little time in bed, right? So I'm going to sing You Light Up My Life. Not now. I can't. Copyright. But that's how I'm going to end every evening of my Lent, singing that song to our Lord and hearing our Lord sing those precious words to me. Good Lord willing, the creek don't rise. We'll do our best to be back here with you again next week. Same bat time, same bat channel. And till then, we pray that the Lord will send His angels to watch over you, to protect you, to guard you and guide you in all of your ways, that he will fill you with the power of his most holy Spirit, that you may truly believe with all of your heart that he loves you just the way you are. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.